Well, thank you very much, Marjorie. These are very kind words, and it's really a pleasure to be part of this very important project. I really enjoyed it very much, and I appreciate that you invite me to be part of the ongoing discussion. As Marjorie has said, I will change now from the more hermeneutical treatment of time and temporality to a more structural subject, which is social justice. I'm writing a book about social justice and aging, hoping to finish it this year. And I have selected some themes that I think would be important in the discussion about the chances to experience a good old age. And I hope you will find them relevant for thinking about your work in this regard. So these are some topics that I will be speaking about. First, some evidence of social inequality in healthy life expectancies. Healthy life expectancies are the number of years that you can expect to live in good health, so without chronic disease, and also disability free. And these life expectancies are hugely different depending on, for instance, socioeconomic position. So I still find them shocking, and I want to bring that to your attention, how important these are. And then, of course, the question, how can we approach this in terms of social justice? So not just utilitarian, but what does it mean for social justice? And then I have a part of my book which is criticizing the social justice and aging theories that have appeared since the 1980s, at a time when I think inequality has hugely risen. They have totally evaded the topic of social inequality. And this is very annoying for me, and I often use my indignation. So that's how I started to do aging studies, that I use my indignation and annoyance and irritation as a source to work. And this gives energy, for me at least. And then I will finish with some thoughts about aging autonomy and independence. These will be very sketchy, but I hope they will be useful. But let me begin by distinguishing two discourses about aging. The first, the most dominant one, emphasizes the homogeneity of older people. They are supposed to be the same or becoming more and more the same. Speaking about aging in terms of old age also shows this tendency to generalize. Often they are seen as being all deficient, incompetent, or needing help. But in some political debates, older people are portrayed as being well off and even unjustifiably advantaged compared to young children or the young adults who are, moreover, supposed to care for them or even pay their pensions. The second discourse is usually more positive about aging people and protests against this homogenization, emphasizing that what is called old age may actually be the longest phase of life during which people become more and more different from each other. This discourse highlights and celebrates the diversity and individuality of older people. Based on research, we can say that the diversity discourse comes closer to reality. A more important question is, however, whether some differences are more important than others, and whether major problems that older adults are confronted with, differentiating their situation from others, are the result of inevitable processes of decline or socially constituted. There is one important, rather cynical way in which older people become more homogeneous as they get older. This is the result of so-called selective mortality. The group of older people who remain alive and well into relatively high ages become more homogeneous. This is, however, not a sign that social inequality is becoming less important as people get older, because social inequality is the main reason that more deprived people are dying sooner than the less deprived. Old age is not the end of inequality, it's inequality's end game. So that will be my motto, so to speak. In thinking about living a good life in old age, we can hardly ignore one of the most solid findings in public health research, the social gradient in health. This implies that people with a relatively low level of education, occupational status, or level of income tend to live shorter lives and have a higher prevalence of disease. These inequalities in health have been found in all Western countries and usually amount to between 10 and 20 years difference in disability-free life expectancy, quite important for living a good life in old age. On the slide, you see the differences between those of the English population who are most deprived and those who are least deprived. Those who are worst off live on the average 10 years shorter than the wealthiest. This is the green line. The red line indicates the years one can expect to live in good health. Without chronic disease, here the difference amounts to almost 20 years. Unequal chances to enjoy a good old age are already coming into play at a very early age. Although there is much attention for the effects of adult choices on health and the idea that chronic disease comes from bad health decisions of adults, there's also growing evidence that gestation, quality of fetal nutrition, maternal health, nutritional status, or toxin exposure throughout childhood may continue to play a burdening role during the whole life course. Since the late 1980s, there has been much research on the fetal origins of adult disease, a research paradigm that was initiated by studies demonstrating that adults with cardiovascular disease had been disproportionately low birth weight babies. This is also sometimes called the Barker hypothesis after the leading author of these early publications. Further research over the last decades has shown that poor growth in utero may lead to a predisposition for a variety of chronic disorders, such as cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and hypertension. This research shows the developmental importance of environmental factors during gestation when certain predispositions may be formed. The impact of the environment, for better or for worse, continues throughout childhood, adolescence, young adulthood, and later life. Moreover, environmental factors continue to play an important role in the question whether predispositions actually develop into health problems. Low birth weight babies, for instance, are only at risk for non-insulin dependent diabetes if they get more food than they need. However, research on this so-called long arm of childhood that reaches into later life also shows that early influences are not per se determining later outcomes. Bad dispositions can be overcome and good dispositions can be ruined. Apart from dramatic situations or genetic effects, negative effects on intrauterine exposures can often be modified during the life course if the environments become more and remain more favorable. So adult health behavior and the quality of environments in a broad sense are still important and require responsible attention. It may be good to add some comments on a discussion about the underlying causalities. On the one hand, we have the health selection hypothesis, which states that differences in health lead to differences in social position. In other words, those who are in good health are able to achieve favorable positions in society. Those in poor health have worse chances and will only achieve low status positions. And on the other hand, we have the social causation hypothesis, which states that the general circumstances of those who live in higher socioeconomic positions are far more beneficial to their health than the circumstances of those who live in lower socioeconomic positions. The social differences in health would therefore, according to this hypothesis, be the result of inequalities in resources, support, knowledge, or behavior. Apart from specific cases, I think it's fair to say that in general, the social causation hypothesis carries more weight. Socioeconomic circumstances have already an important influence on early childhood and education, with major implications for chances to find good work and income on the labor market. Different factors appear to accumulate and interact to form favorable patterns, but also and especially harmful patterns. So the negativity clusters stronger than the favorable developments. Such as polluted environments, bad housing, bad parental health, teenage mothers, domestic violence, insufficient emotional and instrumental support, bad public facilities, bad public transportation, bad schools, poor chances to find good work, unsafe neighborhoods, feelings and experiences of impotence and alienation, and especially disadvantageous circumstances have long-term effects. They tend to be continued over the life course and to be transmitted to the next generation. So we conclude that socioeconomic circumstances, in a broad sense, have a major impact on the chances to enjoy a relatively long, disability-free and healthy life in old age. The nature of poverty has changed. In developed countries, poverty is a product of inequality. People do not die from famine, but those at the bottom of the socioeconomic scale will still have shorter healthy lives than those in more advantaged positions. This may be relatively clear, but it's not easy to establish the precise causes behind these facts. To begin with, the difference is not just one between poor on the one side and rich on the other. Rather, there is a social gradient in health. The chances to become chronically ill or to die are distributed according to a social hierarchy, including income differences. In the slide I showed earlier, this was also clearly visible. That social inequality in health is not a matter of the poor versus the rich has been impressively demonstrated by a longitudinal research project on the health of more than 10,000 Whitehall civil servants that has been running since the mid-1970s, conducted by Michael Marmot and colleagues. The initial intention of this research project was to study whether the highly stratified environment of the British civil service affected the health of the people working there. The lasting advantage of this particular project is that its population is not as diverse as many other studies of social class, where occupations may be very different and difficult to compare. Included in the study were a range of different diseases, such as heart disease, some cancers, chronic lung disease, gastrointestinal disease, depression, suicide, sickness absence, back pain, and general feelings of ill health. One of the most astonishing outcomes was that those who were lower in the hierarchy would sooner become chronically ill and also die earlier than those in the next stage. And this continued to be the case over the six major grades of the hierarchy. Moreover, the general outcome of what initially seemed to become an interesting study of a specific, typically British, old-fashioned occupational culture was corroborated by many other studies in developed countries. So the social gradient in health is not a phenomenon confined to the British civil service. It has been found throughout the developed world. Of course, there's ongoing discussion about many important aspects of this research, but the general pattern has been confirmed in many studies. For instance, a research project in Sweden has shown that individuals with a PhD have lower mortality than those with a master's degree, who have lower mortality than those with a bachelor degree, and so on down the educational hierarchy. Such differences are indeed not a matter of poverty. Why would people with a master's degree tend to die earlier than those with a PhD? Another surprising outcome of this research project is that healthcare plays such a relatively minor role. Because of England's National Health Service, inequality in access to healthcare, which is still a problem in the US, is ruled out as a possible cause of the social gradient. That there might be something wrong in the way the NHS is functioning, which would explain the social gradient, is also unlikely because other developed countries where the social gradient has been observed also have universal access to medical care. In the Whitehall studies, there was also no evidence of a possible undertreatment of the less privileged. The lower the position in the occupational hierarchy, the more medical investigations and interventions were performed. The higher rate of interventions in lower grade matched proportionally the higher rate of disease. So health inequalities are not just a matter of unequal access to healthcare. It's above all a matter of not getting ill, or rather not getting the most life-threatening diseases. Seeing the results, status stress in the sense of not experiencing autonomy or control over one's situation and the quality of the circumstances in which people live and work appear to be important explanatory factors. Are such problems in any way related to questions of social justice? I suggest they are. But what would be social justice? I propose that the best answer is that we do not know what social justice is, but we know what injustice looks like and feels like. Justice in the fullest sense has never been realized. It is, to speak with Derrida, à venir, or to come. As should be seen in the traditional Jewish perspective of expectation that we find also in thinkers like Adorno, Horkheimer, Levinas, or Bloch. The quest for justice is an ongoing critical questioning which transcends empirical forms. It is never really satisfied, nor should it be. How can we approach questions of justice more concretely? In this case, social justice. First, we need to take human suffering seriously and should try to understand its roots or causes. Next, we should try to respond in ways that we would like to see when we would be in similar situations, and to act in ways that improve situations that generate suffering. In articulating criteria of criticizing inequality, there is of course also a place for thinking about what equality might be. Over the last decades, however, we have seen in theories of social justice and aging by authors such as Dworkin, Arnson, Norman Daniels, and Callahan, an abundance of abstract constructions of what equality might look like with little or no intention for empirically existing inequalities. Therefore, I would like to distinguish two ways of approaching social inequality. An influential example of an abstract construction of equality is given in Jefferson's famous words from the body of the 1776 Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. These words introduce equality as the essence of independence and justice, but they stand in a particular relationship to the people of the young United States they pretend to represent. Indeed, the founding fathers thought only of men, moreover, only of men like themselves. They took for granted that slaves, black men, Native Americans or women were not included in the creation of equals. It seems that for the founding fathers, the famous sentence primarily meant a rejection of the idea that men like themselves would be inferior to those of noble descent. They opposed the English and French culture of stratified blood. The idea that the world would consist of people who were born as princes, barons or dukes on the one side and ordinary people as their obedient followers on the other side. However, the founding fathers in their turn continued an equally long tradition of powerful male heads of the family who saw themselves as independent citizens, the sole representatives of civilization and humanity. Even for the Greek founding fathers of democracy, like Plato and Aristotle, women, dependent men or slaves were not regarded as citizens. The solemn statement, "All men are created equal," is an example of positive theories of equality that articulate what equality might mean without confronting these theories with the inequalities among the people they represent. The founding fathers seemed especially keen on preserving their particular privileges and the equality they enjoyed amongst each other. In Simon Sharma's fascinating story of the struggle to freedom by thousands of African-American slaves, who fled the plantations to fight behind British lines in the American Revolution, he recounts how George Washington called the British governor of Virginia an arch traitor to the rights of humanity because he had promised to free the slaves who went over to the British. This stands in strong contrast with the critical orientation of one of the major sources of inspiration for the American Declaration of Independence, the Dutch 1581 Act of Abjuration. In 1782, John Adams, the first ambassador to the Netherlands and later the second president of the United States, added his signature to this act in gratitude for the early recognition of the new American state by the Dutch. The Brits were not amused, affirming the special historical bond between the Netherlands and the US. He may have missed, however, an important difference in orientation between the two founding documents. The Dutch Act of Abjuration addressed much more directly the experiences of repression. God did not create the people slaves to their prince to obey his commands, whether right or wrong, but rather the prince for the sake of the subjects, without which he would be no prince, to govern them according to equity. And when he does not behave thus, but on the contrary oppresses them, seeking opportunity to infringe their ancient customs and privileges, exacting from them slaving compliance, then he is no longer a prince but a tyrant, and the subjects are to consider him in no other view. The difference between positive and negative theories of equality has something to do with Amartya Sen's criticism of transcendental approaches in theories of justice that pretend to present the perfect theory of justice. The Nobel Prize laureate Sen aimed at John Rawls's theory of justice, which he also criticized for focusing one-sidedly on the equal distribution of resources. He insists that the main focus of equality should be on the capabilities of persons, how they are enabled or empowered. Somebody in a wheelchair needs more resources to achieve the same level of opportunities to participate in society than an able-bodied person. And moreover, social context must adapt to their needs. Giving more equal resources to people in unequal situations results not in equality, but in more inequality. Sen's criticism of transcendental approaches to justice, including abstract constructions of perfect equality, has lost nothing of its force, as we shall see later in discussing contemporary theories of equality. But it hits his criticism that it would be inadequate to give equal resources to people in unequal situations appears to be completely outdated. In the contemporary world, there is no equal distribution of resources as proposed by Rawls, but those who have less also receive less. We live in times of what has been called the Matthew principle in the study of social inequality. For unto everyone that has shall be given, and he shall have abundance, but from him that hath not shall be taken away even that what he hath, which is a quote from the Evangelist. The next slide shows how the relationship between the bottom 50% and the top percent of the US national income has completely reversed since the late 1970s. There's a clear turning point around 1978 and 1979. While the poverty of the developing world has steadily declined, poverty within the developed world has increased, especially amongst those who traditionally enjoyed a privileged position, such as male whites in the US, inspiring nostalgic nationalism. Over the life course, as people are getting older, inequality within birth cohorts has been growing steadily and has accelerated since the late 1970s. The situation is a bit more extreme in the US, but the UK and other countries are not far behind. Profits are not trickling down, the famous promise of Clinton, but they are sucked upwards. While taxes, at the same time, especially corporate taxes, are lowered, which depletes the funds for public policies and public health. Now we see that the first two decades after the Second World War have been special. There was full employment in a time of reconstruction, and governments invested broadly in the futures of their population, such as pensions, healthcare, and education for the growing number of children. However, when birth rates began to drop significantly during the 1970s, alarmed demographers began to warn that in the future, many older people would become a burden for a much smaller group of young people. Moreover, the economic recession following the oil crisis of 1973 led to drastic reductions in public spending, and the public debate about aging began to change. The basic fear was that there would be too many older people to take care of. Moreover, as life conditions in general improved, they appeared to live longer and longer. Older people were increasingly portrayed as relatively well off, using up all healthcare resources and a burden to young people who had much worse prospects to age well. This led, especially in the US, to a debate about generational equity that still continues. At the beginning of the 1980s, as the new realities of market forces under the guidance of Reagan and Thatcher began to eat away at the social protection of vulnerable groups of citizens, analytical ethical discourse was looking for an approach that would acknowledge the new realities of the market, but still articulate egalitarian concern. Rawls's approach to justice was seen as too soft and outdated, as he pleaded for a political system that would be optimal for the worst off. Sen's capabilities approach was also perceived as too vulnerable for attacks from libertarians, that egalitarians want the same outcomes for everybody, regardless of their efforts. Since the beginning of the 1980s, we have witnessed the rise of a defensive form of egalitarianism that has been ducking away from the self-confident attacks of libertarian thinkers who maintained, like von Hayek or John Lucas, that striving for equality is futile because humans are not equal and will remain so. We can secure equality in certain respects between members of certain classes for certain purposes and under certain conditions, but never, and necessarily never, equality in all respects between all men for all purposes and under all conditions. The egalitarian is doomed to a life not only of grumbling and everlasting envy, but of endless and inevitable disappointment. This is, of course, a caricature of equality that opposes equality to all possible differences between people. Or they accuse egalitarians of equalizing all talents and taking goods away from the deserving. This would result in a general leveling down, because free riders, lazy people, limitless spenders, or foolish investors would always be bailed out. A major problem would be to undermine personal responsibility by guaranteeing income independent of people's choices. The result of egalitarian ambitions to eliminate differences between people or solve the problems of some of them would be that everybody will be worse off in the end. And the end may be referred to as communism or the end of the free world, to be sure to stop thinking about better ways to approach social inequalities. To be on the safe side of pledging loyalty to the American dream, the proponents of this new post-Rawlsian and Sennian egalitarianism propose that social inequality is not bad if it results from choices people have made. Some like to work hard and have high incomes, some do not and prefer to enjoy leisure. Therefore, the fruits of hard work, successful gambles, or risky enterprise should not be redistributed but remain with those who gained them. The platform from which the so-called luck egalitarianism approaches issues of inequality is autonomous choice. If individuals choose or decide to be poor and in miserable conditions, that is unfortunate, but that choice should be respected. According to Arneson, this thought is the nub of the doctrine of luck egalitarianism that has most elaborately been articulated in writings by Ronald Dworkin. Jerry Cohen has acknowledged Dworkin's historical achievement. Dworkin has, in effect, performed for egalitarianism the considerable service of incorporating within it the most powerful idea in the arsenal of the anti-egalitarian right, the idea of choice and responsibility. There's no space here to elaborate on the specifics of Locke egalitarianism and its influence on thinkers about justice and aging, such as Norman Daniels. Those who were present during my lecture in Bergen last year may recall that I have given a brief overview of the main positions. Three characteristics of these approaches, however, stand out. The first is the already mentioned emphasis on autonomous choice and individual responsibility. The second is an impressive amount of work trying to answer the question what equality might be, including bizarre comparisons between a disability that restricts one's freedom and a genetically determined, hence also restrictive, expensive taste for caviar or exquisite wine. Other examples of such abstract constructions of equality are suggestions to compensate for being temperamentally gloomy, stupid, or ugly. Van Parijs proposes that the equal right to get married implies, when male partners are scarce, that every woman should be given an equal tradable share in the pool of eligible bachelors and have to bid for partnership rights so that wealth is distributed from the successful brides to the losers. All these sophisticated constructions are at great distance from empirically existing forms of inequality. Usually they are assumed away. Like Norman Daniel states at the beginning of his work on justice and aging, we have put interpersonal issues of justice outside the frame of our problem by assuming we have already solutions for them. Well, this is quite a statement. The same neglect of social inequality is true of those who are opposed to Daniels, like McCurley. The eagerness to construct a form of equality that will allow full responsibility of each individual for him or herself not only forgets the constitutive forces of society, but also neglects the solidarity between people. The whole point is to emphasize that individuals are responsible for their lives and do not have an ethical claim to be helped if they end up in trouble. Dworkin exclaims, I show respect for others when I do not appropriate resources that are properly theirs, when I do not exceed my fair share at their expense. The moral goal of this approach appears to be to ensure that people's lives are the result of their decisions and that they can live the life they have chosen. Everybody would reap the bitter or sweet fruits of their decisions or choices. Aging is assumed to be a lifelong process of autonomous choice without asking whether such autonomy can always realistically be assumed. In this sense, these authors do not go beyond the general idea about aging that we find in the media. Recently, there has been the publication of an extensive review on the ways in which older adults are represented in the US media and on the internet. These media play an important public role as they select and amplify the messages that enter into public conversations about aging. By consistently telling certain stories and excluding others, the media discourse creates and reinforces public understandings over time. This has often been described as a drip-drip effect, as these stories steadily carve a channel in the public's imagination that shapes the way members of the public think about a particular issue. First, older adults, and particularly older women, are grossly underrepresented in the media when compared to other age groups. Second, when the media feature older adults, they present them as examples of two opposed perspectives on aging, either as frail, diseased, senile representatives of the aging as decline perspective, who need expensive long-term care, or as active, healthy, wholly independent representatives of the defying aging perspective, vibrant and independent seniors. The aging as decline perspective is usually unfolded in the form of the demographic crisis narrative, warning of impending crisis due to an aging population. A silver tsunami would threaten to disrupt society as we know it. Although countries like Japan or Germany have already been living for years with a population of around 25% have been 65 years or older, a rise to around 19% by 2030 is constructed as a catastrophe for the United States. in such a situation, it would be everyone for himself. So individuals should take the necessary precautions to survive being flooded by numerous older people who have supposedly made the wrong decisions and have consequently become poor or demented. The most popular narrative in the media and on the internet, however, is the vibrant senior who excels in motivation, willpower, and individual agency. Often these stories turn around epiphany moments in which older adults suddenly realize that their fates are in their own hands, that they must change their lives and become active if they are to enjoy their older years. Becoming active is the way to achieve amazing physical fitness that would lead to a radiant vitality, brightness, cheerful extroversion, and life-affirming optimism. The media attention goes out to older athletes who perform at sensational levels, presenting with their excruciating training schedules idealized ways of aging, promising to overcome disease and depression. Another dominant narrative that is closely related to the former is the independent senior, who represents successful aging by staying in control. It features the ability to sustain positive social relationships without being dependent on them, transportation in the sense of continuing to drive a car, financial independence, and the ability to make decisions about end-of-life care. One of the most striking aspects of these programs is the overemphasis on functionality at the detriment of meaning. Staying active is one of the dominant slogans which bring to mind the Protestant ethic, its numerous proverbs emphasizing that hard work can accomplish anything, are transformed by the media into ways to prevent the most strongly feared aspects of aging, such as dementia. This focuses all the attention on the isolated older person who is confronted with the ultimate reality of his or her own body and must fill a long life in old age that has first been emptied of meaning, setting the stage for its functionalist surrogates of the activating agenda. Caregiving responsibilities are typically not part of this agenda. Besides the tendency to portray older people as isolated individualists, this is probably inspired by another popular idea about older adults. They don't care for others, but are cared for by overburdened young adults, which is grossly inadequate because older adults are often intensely involved in caring for parents, partners, children, or grandchildren. This media research confirms that public discourse about aging proceeds from the assumption that individuals are exclusively responsible for how they age. Individualistic lifestyles would be the solution instead of a socially art of aging. Not only the media, but also the activities of advocacy organizations on the internet reinforce the public's highly individualistic understandings of the aging process. This is in line with Ian Garr's analysis of the way in which television in the US frames political issues. When all individuals are responsible for their own fates, no one is responsible for anyone else. Being confronted with this inflation of autonomous choice, I propose that aging is constituted in the interaction of three forces: nature, society, and agency. All three of them are of constitutive importance for human aging, and none of them is reducible to one of the others. Autonomy, however, is clearly the more vulnerable of the three, because it is a human potential that needs to be developed and protected. This is, of course, especially true for children, but even adults need to live in circumstances that make autonomous choice possible. If there are no realistic alternatives, it does not make sense to speak of autonomous choice. To declare that all humans are autonomous without being concerned about the practical conditions of autonomy is mere ideology. Such preconditions of autonomy need especially to be protected when people get older. In theoretical and practical contexts of aging, autonomy is a notion that typically comes up as soon as a person needs permanent rather than incidental help. Moreover, such situations are usually seen as inherently connected with aging, which is an inevitable interhuman experience as long as we stay alive. Therefore, one would hope that the growing dependence on others would be more strongly integrated with respect for autonomy of the older person. However, at moments when the dependency on others that is characteristic of all human life goes beyond what is regarded as normal, the respect for the person's autonomy is in danger. This is the consequence of a reductionist understanding of autonomy as independence, an independence that is implicitly regarded as the privilege of the so-called normal adult and something that older people should try to maintain. They should try to remain independent. Otherwise, they risk being diagnosed as having lost their autonomy. There is, however, no dichotomy between autonomy and dependence, as suggested by idealized and abstract concepts of independence. Bluntly speaking, independence is a bad and misleading concept. Nobody is independent. The concept of autonomy needs to be understood in relational terms and does not contradict dependency. On the contrary, autonomy and dependence are interrelated. For example, a person in a wheelchair decides that she wants to go to the market, but lets others carry out her decision in the form of pushing the wheelchair to the market. If this situation is understood in terms of a dichotomy, this action opposes a dependent person to an independent one. However, the so-called independent person who pushes the wheelchair acts in the service of the person in the wheelchair, which reverses the roles. It is clear that such situations contain many risks of misunderstanding and misuse of trust. This gets even riskier when somebody decides to let others decide for him. But such situations may be inevitable. They illustrate the importance of extending the concept of autonomy beyond that of the atomistic independent individual. And they highlight the vulnerable nature of autonomy when situations of dependence are misused by others to assume complete control. In that case, the others are not guided by the precarious autonomy of the person in their care, but they also neglect their own autonomy in the sense of being acknowledgeable and responsible actors. Ambivalent situations require reflection and communication. It may look easier to approach them in terms of dichotomies, such as either dependent or independent, but this neglects both the potential risks and richness of these interhuman situations. Defining autonomy as, quote, human agency free of outside intervention and interference may appeal to myths of the strong independent individual or the self-made man, but in such a way it becomes difficult to understand and appreciate the ambivalences and intricacies of what really goes on in the relational field of autonomy. Its many possible variations, such as needing help, denying needs, protesting help, resistance, acceptance, control, or surrender, should not be reduced to dichotomies, but as relational dimensions that must be addressed in communication. We have seen that societal inequalities play a major role in the chances to age well, and this social dimension is crucially left out in discussions about aging and justice. This does not mean that society is not important. I am afraid that it means that the most powerful societal forces that are dominating the agenda without being critically questioned. It has always been a characteristic of power that it prefers to hide. One of the most important points on the agenda of the powers that dominate the developed world is to transform all citizens into entrepreneurs. To a certain degree, the programs of successful aging, productive aging, and active aging can also be seen as forms of entrepreneurial aging. The entrepreneurial citizens should buy their own insurance, mind their own business, and have no ethical claim in case they get into trouble. Their only chance will be to depend on the charity of those who have become extremely rich, thanks to the same dynamics of inequality that put so many others in misery. To protect the preconditions of autonomy and agency, such mechanisms must be brought into the open. There is enough evidence of the plasticity of senescence to support the claim that human aging is not organismically regulated, but it is also not determined in a mechanistic way by life course systems. Human beings are not passive objects. They interact with the world around them, a world that is changing them, but they are also changing the world. Because individuals are confronted with a world that is disproportionately powerful, it is important to try to bring some justice into the world. This will not happen by itself. Autonomous persons must guard the possibilities to live and age in justice and dignity. I thank you.